50 seconds.
It's getting near dawn.
40 seconds.
When lights close the tired eyes, I'll soon be with you, my love.
30 seconds.
Give you my dawn surprise. I'll be with you, darling, soon. I'll be with you when
20 seconds.
Start falling.
Ten, nine, eight, seven, six.
LoveLine is meant for an adult audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Yep, it is LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician and addiction medicine specialist. And tonight, we'd like to welcome back to the show, Jaguares. Huh?
Yeah.
I think I nailed that's Jaguares to you and me.
Have a good pronunciation.
I get that one right. Alfonso Andre and Saul Hernandez is our guest tonight. You guys, what is this, the third time in here?
Second, yeah. I guess.
Second? The first one must have just felt long.
Third time.
It is the third time.
Yeah.
Yes, I knew you guys had been around here for a while. The Latin rock, as we'd talked about the first time, and probably the second time, and now the third time, is really, well, it's going past making inroads, I think, into the American culture. It's here. It's you guys are selling... tickets, selling out the pond, selling millions of albums, up for three Latin Grammy nominations. But who's at the show? Is it exclusively Latino folks, or is it a mixture? And is it becoming more white as the years wear on?
It's becoming more, huh? More mix each time.
There's a lot of also Latinos, but they don't speak Spanish. They've been born here and speak the language, but they like the band.
I went to school with a bunch of those guys.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Jorge Espinoza don't speak a lick of Spanish.
Yeah.
But we can still make fun of him, you know?
Adam Carolla doesn't speak a lick of Italian.
Oh, paisan. Yeah, all right. I can pronounce most of food and cheeses, though. And you guys are from, where was it?
Mexico City.
Mexico City, that's what I wanted to say. Yeah. And you make your homes still there, right?
Well, Saul has moved wisely out of Mexico City because it's really
a
nasty place
to
live.
A lot of crime right now.
Yeah.
I heard it's the smoggiest place on earth, which as a L.A. resident made me feel good because I always figured we were living in the smoggiest place.
I have patients that live down there. Really, the main thing that gets people is the crime.
Yes. It's
very scary.
Very, very
it's
scary.
The crime, and we are like 22 million people in the city and surroundings. And we are a lot of people.
Too much.
Too much traffic.
Well, they got
but,
it.
But it's really nice in the sense of madness, and a lot of things happen in the city. It's really activity.
Surrealistic.
It's nice. I have the.
You guys got a new president now, right?
Yes, a new party ruling.
That's
For 70 years we had the same one.
That's, right.
It was like a dictatorship.
Is it a good thing, have a new one?
We don't like him very much, but the change is good. It's a good thing.
The guy's really, his ego must be brimming because every interview from every Latin guy here, here's how it goes. So you like the new guy? Well, no, we just didn't like the old guy. That seems to be the popular opinion. They hated the old guy. They're not so sure about the new guy, but the new guy, the best thing he has going for him is he's not the old guy.
Yes, absolutely.
And he's like, he's a new guy from the old guy.
Oh, really? He's from the old party? He was from the old party?
This is a new party. But the people vote for against the old party. So this is the one who became more confrontation with the old party. And the people start to believe what happened. And we hope something really
it's gonna change.
Good.
Now, what do you care? You're living. Where are you living now?
Now I escape.
Yeah, but he still lives in Mexico.
Oh, you're still in Mexico, not in Mexico
country,
City.
Yeah, he moved to the beach.
Well, now how does it? I thought the whole place was a beach. How does it work? How do the elections work? I mean, here we do the president once every 4 years. They do
for six years.
6 years?
Mexico, yes.
Yeah. See, if you factor naps in, I think you're on about the same timetable. You know what I'm saying? Mm. This is a little more laid back. All right. We will hear something from Jaguares off the Mission Impossible 2 soundtrack, which is, how'd you make it onto that? How'd that come about?
We really don't know. Some accident happened, and some people from Paramount Pictures called to the office and asked me if I can write a song for the soundtrack. And that's it. I came and I worked with Stuart Copeland.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Stuart Copeland was on the show, I think, about a year and a half ago. Yeah. Smart guy, nice guy.
He's a great musician. Also.
Right.
And we worked together with a couple of friends from Puerto Rico. They played percussions.
Had you worked with Stuart before? Did you know his work from the police?
Yeah, of
Did
course.
Did you want to work with him?
Yeah. Actually, we made...
there was this tribute album to the police made by Latin artists and Saul... was in that one also.
They were talking about that last time.
Right. Yeah. Which song did you do for the tribute album?
I choose one. Does Everyone Stare?
Oh,
it's from the
album?
Regatta de Blanc.
Yeah. Well, the thing about the police is all their names are some kind of Spanish. What does that mean? What are the two? They had the Regatta de something and the Blanco de.
Sendiata mondata?
Yeah, no, what's that mean?
Nothing, absolutely nothing. Well,
they said that means queremos tacos. That was Stuart said in Mexico in the conference press. What means is queremos tacos? Okay, so this is the only signification.
All right, we will, you guys know how the show goes. People call in, they bare their souls, and we make fun of them. Kiki? Oh, boy.
Caller who goes by Kiki.
Hello.
Yes, you're 34 years old. What's up?
Well, I can't have an orgasm when my husband and I are having intercourse. Yeah. And I'm 34 years old. Is it too late to even try? Am I over the hill? What should I do?
When can you have an orgasm?
When I'm having oral sex.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
And you've never been able to have an orgasm through intercourse, right?
Never.
With anybody.
With anybody.
Okay.
Well, you can always work on it with your husband. I mean, you can talk about
that
it.
That was okay.
No, I mean, they give him, you know, sort of, you know what I mean? Just bring it up and work on it and not saying your
it's
usual
not, it's
rut.
It's not going to work.
I've been faking it for so long. I don't.
Oh, have you been faking it?
Yeah, I have. I've
Good
feel
girl.
Bad.
That's
Good
great.
Good girl.
Yeah. Listen, a lot of people get offended when they hear that. I think it's the greatest gift a woman can give to a man, to fake the orgasm.
Right.
You guys comprende with the fake orgasm?
Yes, we comprende. Yes.
That's right. Very good. Wow, I almost had one. Hey, Kiki.
Yes.
Here's how you could possibly have yourself an orgasm while you're having intercourse with your husband.
Okay.
You got a pad and pencil there?
Uh-huh.
Okay, write this.
I've got an ink pen. Right, go.
Write this down.
Okay.
Dildo?
Uh-huh.
Okay, I'm done. Now, get a vibrator, right?
Okay.
And then you get the vibrator going, and you get the clitoral stimulation going while your husband is having intercourse with you.
Right.
Then you have your orgasm while he's in you.
Okay.
Never work.
It'll work.
It'll
sometimes
work.
Sometimes it does.
It can work.
But
it's your only option.
Yeah, it's right.
The only option. Okay.
Right.
So he won't catch on to I'm doing something different.
Listen, guys.
I've been faking it for so long.
No, not about the faking.
No, just tell him. Just tell me when to introduce it.
Guys believe exactly what you want them to believe.
Okay?
Oh, okay. Okay.
All right, Kiki. So you get that vibrator. Not one of those big novelty ones either. Just a small one you can direct the pressure on the clitoris, all right?
Okay, I'll do that.
Okay.
Bye.
Is in Spanish, clitoris, clitoris?
Clitoris, the
clitoris.
Accent.
Oh, I see. Yeah, that's how my grandmother pronounces it. I swear to God, my grandmother pulled me aside and said something was bothering her. She listens to the show. She said, it's not clitoris, it is clitoris. I said, how do you know? I have many friends who are doctors. They all say clitoris. I said, well, Drew's a doctor. She sort of believes, now that we're friends, you're no longer a doctor. You're just one of my F-up buddies. So we looked it up, and it says you can go either way.
Which reminds me, I knew there was something we needed to talk about tonight. Remember last night we left off with the...
Me cramping in a popcorn bucket?
We didn't tell the story.
Okay.
You and I left off with that.
Well, write that down, Drew, and we'll get into it in the next hour. Make yourself a mental note there. Right. Also... I saw the roof of my house on TV today when a medium speed pursuit went right by my house. Did you guys
went up that hill?
Yeah. Did you see any of that?
I heard about it. I didn't realize it went up in the hills.
Did you guys see that car pursuit?
No.
I don't think they would handle it the same
way
in Mexico.
It's a red pickup truck, right?
Yeah. Here
you are a star if you're in one of those.
Yeah. Huh?
You're big celebrity for this guy was on the road for about an hour and 45 minutes.
Or 3 hours.
No, not 3 hours.
That's what I heard.
That's what you heard, but you heard wrong. He was about an hour and 45 minutes, and because of all the lawsuits against the LAPD, these guys are scared to do anything. So not only will they not stop you, they'll just follow you, and they won't even follow you closely because they don't want you to feel pressured. It's a really bizarre thing for a police. You know, it's an interesting ploy for the police or strategy for the cops to adapt, which is this guy's making a run for it. Let's give him room, fellas. And they sit way back. They're 150 feet behind the guy, and they followed him. And he came up my street. He came around the back. He came right around my house. I was just watching it on the news. I saw the guy drive right past my house, right down the hill, and he drove through Travel Town and through the zoo and through Burbank. He came back around to Hollywood again. He went through Silver Lake. Then he got on the freeway, and he drove all the way out to Woodland Hills. He got off.
He
on
stopped
like
in a 7-Eleven. He took some groceries, and he
continued. That's right. He held up a guy at an ATM. They gave him room. They just give you room. And the thing I can't figure out about it is, especially, you know where I live, Drew, up in the hills there. All you'd have to do is when this guy went one direction up the hill, there's only one outlet, and that's the other direction. They could just sent a car up the other direction, just parked it.
Yeah.
There's just no possible way to escape if you did that. They're not interested in stopping them anymore. Huh. There's no spikes. There's no ramming. There's no nothing. And like I said, they don't even follow closely. They're way behind the guy.
That's really
And it goes
weird.
On for hours. Now, in Mexico, that wouldn't happen, would it?
No.
They
shoot them or something.
They'd shoot them. They'd throw a tequila bottle at the guy. They'd do something, right? I mean, how long? Here's what I'd like to know.
No, there is much easy.
How long is the?
We have more. We're more civilized because the police stop, and you take your wallet. You say, "Hey, man, give me a break," and you give money, and that's it.
Nobody ever flees.
Nobody dies. Right. Nobody shoots.
I wouldn't do it either. I bet you we would cut these pursuits by tenfold if you knew you could just hand the guy $50 and be on your way. I mean, that's how it is in Mexico, right? You just grease the guy's palm, give him a little.
Yeah, not all the time, but
most of the time.
Sometimes happens, yeah.
I saw a cop on a police motorcycle in Tijuana. He rode a wheelie down the street. I thought, you don't see a lot of that in L.A. Yeah, all right, Elizabeth.
Yes.
You're 19.
Yes, I am.
What's up?
Okay, my boyfriend's dad's going out of town, and I'm on the pill, and I'm supposed to, like, have my period this week, and I wanted to know if I can just start another packet of pills and not have it, and if it'll be okay.
Your boyfriend's dad is going out of town, so you get to have sex?
Exactly.
I see. And he's living at home, I guess?
Well, yeah.
How old?
We're all going to school.
How old is...
We live at home and mooch off our parents and go to school.
I see. All right. Time for sex. And what was the pill question again?
Can she, in other words, start a packet up without waiting that 1 week in between and not have her period until...
Oh, I see. Yeah.
You can do that. I've done that for people when they have like weddings approaching and that sort of thing.
That's yeah. Sad. Yeah. I hope they tip you for that.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
It can screw things up, though. You can get heavier bleeding, and your cycle's going to be all screwed up, and you can be uncomfortable. And
but you can delay jog the period.
Yeah.
I mean, if you had, I don't know, some long-distance romance, and the guy was coming in from New York for a weekend.
Yep.
Nice.
Not a healthy thing, particularly. Are you on a monophasic pill? What pill are you on?
Orthotricycline?
Yeah, see, it's a little trickier with those tricyclic pills, so...
Who's got a bigger problem with it, you or your boyfriend?
It's his thing.
He's not into that?
Nah.
Yeah.
Tell him to not be such a pussy.
Thank you, Drew. Yeah. You tell him to lighten up.
Well, but so, like, if I started another...
It's part of the wonder that is the female form.
Is it okay, or, like, would I not get pregnant kind of thing?
Yeah, you'll be protected that way.
Okay, and so then it wouldn't start, and then it would start.
Well, you'll have a screwed up period. You'll have some spotting and stuff. It's not a great thing to do. If I were you, I wouldn't recommend it.
Okay.
All right. It's time for him to prove he loves you.
Yeah.
And you do what I do. You put a little compressed air up there. You dry it out. You clean it out a little bit. It's fine. No, compressed air. I don't blow up there. I need about 90 psi. All right, Elizabeth.
Okay, thanks.
All right, hey, listen. But here is a safety tip. Take Dad's good down comforter and go ahead and just roll that off the bed. The last thing you want to do is leave that trail of evidence. Do you know what I'm saying?
Don't worry. We're smart.
Yeah. All right. Good luck to you there.
Vivisection went on in the bedroom.
Brittany?
Yeah?
You're 14?
Yeah.
You're on with Jaguares.
Okay.
That's good, huh?
Okay.
Yeah.
Me and my boyfriend, we were having sex, and I don't know if it was the position. We were in doggy or whatever, and I don't know. I started queefing and all, and like all of my juices just like went all over his stomach.
All right.
And
yeah.
You were squirting.
Right.
Yeah. You guys, they were in the. The doggy, what the hell? What the hell is the dog?
Style.
The
perro.
Perro.
The perrito, se dice in Spanish.
Perrito.
The perrito.
Perrito position?
Perrito position.
Okay. Perrito position?
Little doggy.
Oh, the pequeño perro position?
The perrito.
Right, okay, so that's the doggy position.
Right.
And how do you translate queef? I know. You know, with the, you guys, right? You have a word for that? Not farting.
It's well,
but the
we
noise.
Say it's farting in
oh, you call farting?
It's
flatulencia.
A vagina farting.
Okay, yeah. Good. I like that. All right, so that's what happened. That happens
and
when you're
really
in the
has a weak stomach, doesn't he? As soon as you go down that road,
he doesn't like any farting.
He doesn't like human anything.
Yep. He wants to marry Fembot. Brittany?
Yeah.
All right. So that's pretty natural, except for the part about the fluid flying out.
No, the fluid thing is some women do that, and it's a normal thing. And most men sort of appreciate that. Would you say, Adam?
They do maybe the first time out, but after a few years, it probably gets old. All right?
I think men are always wanting to see the results of their work.
All right. That happened when you had an orgasm?
Huh?
When you had an orgasm, the fluid came out of you?
I don't think I've ever had an orgasm.
Oh, okay. So it's just fluid. See that, Drew? Not great.
I thought it was like coming. Like,
No. Yeah, but not in Brittany's case. Hey, Brittany, how old is this guy?
16.
All right. Oh, slow down, baby. You're 14.
I know.
All right. What are you using for protection?
Nothing.
Oh, my God.
All right.
God.
You'll be pregnant
this
time tomorrow.
When were you last with him?
Saturday.
You still have time to get the morning after pill, right?
Okay.
Oh, she's not going to do that.
1-888 not number too late. 1-888 not too late. Call the number. They'll refer you to someplace locally.
Hey, Brittany.
Pill.
Yeah.
I know you're stupid and young and horny and you make a lot of noise when you have sex and everything, but we're now warning you, okay? Yeah. You're an adult. You're doing it in the perro position, and it's time for you
Perito.
To get some protection, all right?
All right.
Hey,
my friend, we're supposed to be going up there to GYN sometime.
You're going to the gyno?
Right.
Good. All right, get all right, going.
Get that morning after pill. Keep it in your medicine cabinet.
He's got to use protection
or
until
else,
then. You're going to get pregnant,
or else
you idiot.
Get on the pill.
Se ponga un bozal.
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
Perito protection.
Yeah. 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 Yeah, that's what's going on in Mexico City, right? Mm-hmm. Not enough birth control, too many people. Then you get crime, then you get smog, then you got to move. You got to move to the country.
There are too many perrito positions.
That's right. All right. We should hear something from Jaguares.
Right.
What do you say? All right. This is off the Mission Impossible soundtrack, right, Ann? Is that the first one we're playing? Yeah. This one is called Gliding.
Sobre otras manos y me duele la potencia. Soy un intruso en tu deseo y me doy cuenta que sigo siendo tu misterio. Lo desafío y veo que tú estás a mi lado. Ahora sí, crees lo que no, que un sacrificio puede ser.
Gliding from Jaguares off of the Mission Impossible 2 soundtrack. Jaguares is our guest tonight. We're going to take ourselves a little break. When we come back, we'll speak to Michelle, whose 18 boyfriend made out with a stripper at a bachelor party. She wants to know if she should be mad. We'll explain why she shouldn't after this.
You know what I'm saying out there?
Loveline.
Moonlight Express is so exciting.
I love exploring new places.
Oh, like here. Oh. And here. Soldier
Man! You seem to be moving pretty fast.
Well, yeah.
I have pleasurable news about new Trojan Pleasure Mesh latex condoms, designed with a mesh pattern of over 300 raised passion X's. Only Trojan lets you share this kind of stimulating pleasure.
All aboard.
My job is done here. New Trojan Pleasure Mesh. Trojan, America's number one condom. The most trusted for a most stimulating experience.
Visit the Army Reserve Job Bank at GoArmyReserve.com and hear about jobs in medicine, aviation, or telecommunications. The Army Reserve Job Bank has many jobs in your area. Just plug in your zip code and you'll find listings for everything from PCs to MPs. Serve as little as 1 weekend a month, 2 weeks a year. Learn skills that can help in college or a career. Sound good? It is. Visit the Army Reserve Job Bank at GoArmyReserve.com. Paid for by the U.S. Army Reserve.
Hi, I'm Serenity, and these are my friends, Missy and Stephanie.
You know, a lot of things happen to us every day that we have no control over.
But HIV and other sexually transmitted diseases aren't things that just happen to you. You do have a choice.
You can choose to use a condom, have safe sex, and take control of your life.
Asking for a condom isn't stupid. It's smart. It shows that you care about yourself and your partner. You can do something about sexually transmitted diseases.
Use a condom.
Every partner.
Every time.
We do.
A message brought to you by Wicked Pictures and AIDS Project Los Angeles.
Oh, come on, have a drink.
No, thanks.
Just one little drink.
I don't want to.
Chicken, everyone else is.
I said no.
What a nerd. One little drink won't kill you.
You've heard it all before. Be cool, join the crowd, have a drink, even though you're not 21.
Let's go, she's no fun.
Make the right choice. Don't give in. Underage drinking is dumb and dangerous.
Look out!
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Somewhere in our community is a mother whose drug abuse once left her unable to care for her kids. There's a father, too, whose alcohol use drove his wife and children away. There's a boyfriend whose drug use frightened his girlfriend into giving him an ultimatum: get help or I'm gone. Help is available. It's in the form of treatment programs for drug abuse and alcohol problems. And the good news is that these programs are making a big difference in people's lives. With proper treatment, mothers and fathers, sweethearts and coworkers, friends and neighbors are overcoming drug and alcohol problems and reclaiming their lives. Isn't it great that treatment works? To find out about drug and alcohol treatment programs that can help, call 1-800-662-HELP. That's 1-800-662-HELP. There is help, and it works. A public service of this station and the Center for Substance Abuse Treatment.
Dad, I don't think our campfire's totally out.
Are you kidding me? I know when a campfire's out.
Did you drown the fire with water and stir it with a stick?
No, it's out. We don't have to...
Who said that?
Frank, it's a talking moose with sunglasses.
And a bunch of singing and dancing forest animals.
We know we can count on you to do what Smokey says.
And when your folks desire to build a fire,
hot, hot,
clear brush and branches away.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And keep water nearby like you oughta.
We're all counting on you.
Okay, I poured water on the fire. I stirred it with a stick. Everybody walk slowly toward the RV.
Dad, these are just Smokey's friends.
Only you can prevent forest fires.
Frank, it's Smokey.
Nice hat, Smokey. You want the rest of my peanut butter sandwich?
Dad!
Visit Smokey at www.smokeybear.com. Brought to you by the USDA Forest Service, the National Association of State Foresters, and the Ad Council.
It's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. It's Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Alfonso and Saul are both here from Jaguares. And Drew apparently is out of cough, and he's about to throw a hissy fit. You all right, Drew?
Just trying to catch Danielle's attention there. Just
all right.
An eye.
All right. You need some sort of, you know, you need one of those buzzers that the teller presses with
on
her
the foot,
foot.
Yeah.
When
yeah.
the hold-up
yes.
man comes in.
Oh, yes.
Big red light goes off over Danielle's phone.
Actually, while I was sort of going through those machinations, I was thinking about the fact that there were demonstrations today, the
yes.
Adam Carolla demonstrations.
There were a handful of unemployed actors who showed up at the KROQ studios this morning to demonstrate against me and some comments that I made against my own union, SAG and AFTRA, when I did the...
I actually support this issue.
Craig Kilborn show. Oh, who cares? That's my point.
Well, you haven't even thought it through. You just don't like people whining, that's all.
I'm just... listen, actors... Here's the problem with actors, and anyone who knows any can identify with this. You have a very, very bad combination between incredibly inflated ego and a very wounded child, all in the same person. So you have total grandiosity meets a sort of hurt little being. And that combo is a horrible combination. I don't mind grandiose, inflated people.
Oh, no, wait a minute. Grandiose
if they mean
have.
It. If they mean
they
it.
They always have that. Underneath.
There's a handful of guys out there who really can back it up, like myself, thank you, who are I'm fine with. I enjoy those kind of people. Those are what you call colorful.
I call that sociopath.
But the actors, here's the combo. Grandiose meets wounded child meets tons of free time equals picketing and letter writing. They're on strike. I told them to get back to work, essentially, and quit their whining. And now they're all upset, writing me letters and picketing and so on and so forth.
Well,
now,
correct me if I'm wrong.
What?
For you. We have not discussed this, by the way.
Yes.
We're discussing it for the first time right now. It was a joke.
What?
What you were saying.
Not really, no.
It was a joke.
What are you talking about?
You really don't care. You don't care either way.
I don't really care.
But it was a joke.
No, not really.
If it weren't a joke, you wouldn't have mentioned it.
Well, I said it because I was trying to get a laugh, but I do feel that way for the most part.
Yeah, but really you don't care.
No, I don't care.
Okay.
Listen, if somebody can get paid for a job that they do years after they've done it, more power to them. But I wouldn't cry about it. As I'd mentioned on Kilborn, if I'm with a hooker, I don't have to give her 50 cents every time I whack off to her in years to come. I just pay her the 150 for the one time. And when I was a carpenter, when I built a deck on someone's house, I didn't get 10 bucks every time they threw a barbecue. They paid me for my day's work. I got my money and I went home. I didn't keep ringing them like a bar rag. Fine, get back to work. That's all I'm saying. Drew, I appreciate you trying to get me out of trouble by giving me the opportunity to say I was just kidding. And I am, in the sense that I'm trying to get a laugh, and it's true, I don't care either way.
I know you don't care.
I know I don't care, but that's the funny thing.
And I actually would support them.
They want me to apologize for not caring.
You haven't thought it through, so you don't even know if you care or not, but at this point,
you
don't
care.
So.
I just don't care. Yeah. All right, they should all get back to work. That's all I'm saying. Michelle?
Yeah.
You're 18?
That's right.
What's up?
Okay, well,
hold on a second. You realize we're in a union, Drew.
I know.
Where the president of our union played the teacher from Boy Meets World. Do you understand what kind of insanity that is?
It's impressive.
All right. That's all I want you to know. How can you take that union seriously?
Ronald Reagan was the president of that union.
Michelle?
Oh, wait, Adam.
Uh-oh. Looks like some of Culver City's finest have slid into the building. Hope I didn't do anything wrong.
Yeah.
Michelle?
Wait, maybe they can tell us something about the
what's
chase.
What's up? Oh, leave him alone. Michelle, what's up?
Okay, I've been going out with my boyfriend for a little over 2 years now. He's a really good guy. He loves me a lot. I know that. He's a really good person.
All right, stop convincing us. Just tell us what
did he do?
Okay.
Oh, he made out with the stripper?
No, that's incorrect. He went to his friend's bachelor party, and, you know, the stripper was jumping around, putting whipped cream on her boobs and sticking her chest into people's faces.
That whore.
And people were licking the whipped cream off of it.
Yeah.
Well, my guy did the same thing. And, you know, it really hurt me when he told me. And
he told you?
Well, yeah, I asked him what happened, and he told me, well, she came, she did her little lap dance, and she my face also.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, did you also lick him like everyone else did? And he's like, well, yeah, you know, it was just fun. It's not a big deal. I didn't.
Right. You know. All right. So what do you care? Not a big deal.
I know
that. He's the world's greatest guy.
Just the thought of it, it hurts. And it was really, I usually don't get upset with a lot of things. I don't let things bother me.
Oh, yes, you do. You let everything bother you. Where's Daddy?
Daddy?
Yeah.
He's downstairs.
Yeah. You like him?
No.
Why not?
He's not the best father or husband.
Did he cheat on Mommy?
No.
What'd he do? Why isn't he a good husband?
Well... He forced my mom to have sex with him a lot. And so I kind of witnessed this as I was growing up.
Well, now we're getting somewhere.
Yeah.
So he raped your mom and you witnessed it?
Well, you know, I wasn't watching, but I heard. I knew what was going on.
All right. Well, that's kind of a pretty traumatic thing for a young girl, right?
Well, yeah, but...
So those sorts of objectifying, demeaning,
yep.
powerless, or disempowering situations can be really important to you.
All right. That's
and
where
to any
it's
woman,
coming from.
And for any woman, this, although Adam has no sense of this, this is a...
Well, I don't care. Same
with
the
actors
here.
But it's a violation of trust, and it's gross. It's
something your wife's listening.
No. I think. Listen, women are remember, they are a higher form of the species.
Yeah, they're so smart. Why do we run them around?
No, but because men, when they behave as they will, it's a real disappointment. It's a deflation. They're like, gross.
Okay, let me say two things. Michelle has an energy in this
yes.
department.
Oh, yes.
I felt it immediately. Yes. I tapped right into yes. her daddy, and it turns out her daddy did horrible things to her mommy.
I'll give you that.
And any time a male interacts with somebody in her life, it's going to remind her of something. Yes, your boyfriend, who's the world's greatest guy, fine, leave it at that. He just did what everyone else does at a bachelor party. Big deal. This is what young guys do. You go in and get some therapy for what happened to you. And I don't want to defend the guy, but this is something that guys do all the time. It's no big deal. Let it go. Get some therapy.
Have
Thank you,
been watching The Big Brother at all?
And number two, hold on a second. It's interesting. I had a conversation about licking whipped cream off of boobs just before I left my house today on the way into the station.
Imagine
I talked
that.
To a friend of mine who's in Montreal, and he's up there for the comedy festival, and he was an old roommate of mine. And the first thing I said was, you having a good time? How are the strip clubs? He said, the strip clubs are great. Anything goes in Montreal. And it's cheap. It's 10 Canadian, which is like $6 American. But anything goes is great, except for you don't want to be licking some boob that some fat Canadian guy who'd had 16 Molsons under his belt was suckling on 5 minutes earlier. And I said, you're right. And he said, yeah, you know me. When I go to the bathroom, I use a towel to open the door. I'm not going to be sucking on some hooker's boob.
Who is this?
This is Cordy.
Oh, my God.
So I said, that's right. And I said, they should carry moist towelettes, wipe themselves down in between guys. And then I said, if I were a stripper, that'd be my name. Moist Talette. And I'd pass myself off as a Frenchman. And I would say, my name is Moist Talette. And it gave everyone the feeling of cleanliness. You know how a name can sort of invoke certain feelings?
It would come across as Toilette.
Again, I'll pronounce it. Hello, ladies. My name is Moist Talette. And I would pull one of those things right out of my fly. I'd have the dispenser in underneath my shorts, and they could keep pulling them out. Be like a clown, like when all the clowns get in the
magician,
car.
Yeah.
Moist Talette. That's a good name for a French stripper.
But I want you to watch. I want you to do me a favor, and this is not
what.
And just for promotion purposes, that the stripper on Big Brother is challenging my our sort of routine assessment of stripper and what puts him in that position.
I never heard of Big Brother. What is
that? It's a TV show. It's pretty much every night on
cable?
CBS. Yeah,
CBS?
CBS, yeah.
Oh, that's old people's channel.
And
I don't watch it.
I have to analyze some of the stuff that's going on in that house. And
you're on that show now?
Yeah, I'm on the show.
Ooh, boy, they're scraping
desperate.
The
yes,
barrel.
Yes,
yeah.
They are. Yeah. Thank you for the interruption.
What happened to Dr. Art Uline or Dina Dell or one of the real TV doctors?
Not cool enough, I guess.
Hmm.
But she is really interesting. I mean, I would just be interested in your thoughts if you tune in. It's like one night.
When's it on?
It's on pretty much every night at 8.
All right. Well, I usually don't watch a lot of TV.
Just watch, because this one is because I think there's more
True,
going on
you know,
usual.
I only watch
Asshole.
6.5 hours of TV a day, so I don't always have time to squeeze new shows into my slots. Liz?
Hi.
You're 20?
Yes.
What's up?
Oh, my God. Saul?
See?
Can I talk to Saul?
Yeah, here he is.
Hi, how are you? Oh, my God, I'm such a big fan. I'm one of your biggest fans, and I wish I could have been there in your concert on Saturday, but I couldn't get tickets.
At the Pond?
I'm not sure exactly where it is. Where
right. Yeah, that's why she couldn't get tickets. Yeah.
I couldn't get tickets, right.
Well, you're calling from L.A., though, right?
Right.
All right.
Right.
You got a question for Saul?
Yes, I wanted to know if you guys are going to make an English channel, an English CD. I was turning on LoveLine right now, and I heard them, and I'm like, what the hell's going on?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
So I was just wondering if you're going to release in English.
Well, not now. First, I have to go to some Harmon Hall Some
classes.
Even
in Spanish.
Yeah,
because, you know, the fact, for English.
The fact is that I don't
listen.
I don't think in English, so I can roll. I can write in English. So
yeah, but well, hold on
that's
a second.
So
I think in Spanish, thankfully. So here's the deal: can't you just write the songs in Spanish and then translate them into English and then learn? I mean, you speak
in
decent
French?
English. Yeah, Moistelet. You can sing, you know, I mean, just phonetically. I mean, the Beatles had, like, Love Me Do in German or something. You know, all bands do that
it
all the time.
Horrible.
Okay, it sounds like crap. That's true, but you could do it.
Yeah, but why
yeah,
do
of
it?
Course you
it
can sounds do
like
it.
Oh, I see. All right, well, maybe you have a point. Hey, Liz.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to do a all-French radio show coming up in a few months,
all
right?
I would listen to it, Adam. Oh. You are so sexy. Your voice. I go to sleep with it every fucking night.
Every second night?
Every second night. What you know what my French name is? It is Patrice Moistelet. Patrice, first name. Moist, middle name. And, of course, Talet being my parents' name. All right, Liz. Uh-huh.
Okay.
All right.
Best of luck to you guys. No.
Gracias.
So
hasta luego.
Bye.
All right. Hey, Dr. Andrew. You speak the French, do you not?
Oui.
Speak a little French. Send us to a commercial break in French.
I don't know how they do that.
No. Come on, you idiot. Just say something in French.
Il faudra que du partition.
Say it again.
Il faudra que du partition.
What's that say?
We have to leave.
Say we'll be back with more Jaguares and Loveline after this.
Nous retournons avec plus de Jaguares. Après cela.
Oh, merci.
Come on, back in a minute.
How was school today, Rebecca?
We learned what the Earth was like a long time ago, way back in the 1990s.
Oh.
Grandpa, did you ever taste water?
Oh, my, no. By the time I was a boy, water, if you could find it, was pretty much unfit to drink. But I hear tell, long ago, children used to make lemonade with actual tap water and drink it on hot, sunny days.
Really?
Yeah, and sometimes they'd fill balloons with water and toss them at each other and laugh or run through the sprinkler singing and carrying on. And then after a day of playing, their folks would put them in a tub, fill it with water and bubbles and scrub them until they were squeaky clean.
Wow. Why didn't people try to save the water?
Well, I guess they didn't think one person could make a difference.
Thousands of Americans make a difference every day. For example, over 900 million tons of untreated sewage is no longer discharged into our nation's waters. A message from ECHO, the Earth Communications Office.
He's the... We're gonna try to get some more
okay, stuff. Class. This part of the museum is known as the Hall of Trees.
What's a tree?
Large plants that once covered much of the Earth. This is a full-scale model of a maple tree.
Wow. What are those green things?
Those were called leaves. They took in sunlight, nourished the tree, expelled oxygen, creating air for people to breathe.
People didn't breathe out of air tanks?
No, then air was everywhere. The sky was blue, even the ocean was blue.
The ocean was blue?
And filled with fish.
Fish.
When you protect the Earth, you protect your health and that of your children. We're making progress. There has been a significant improvement. 20 years ago, air pollution in Los Angeles exceeded health standards on 4 out of every 5 days. But we still have a long way to go.
Here's the Hall of Weather. Press that button and you'll hear a rainfall.
Why'd they need rain?
Without rain, a flower couldn't grow.
What's a flower?
One person can make a difference. A message from ECHO, the Earth Communications Office.
Personally, I'm so sick of hearing about the environment.
I know. What's everyone so worried about?
51 million Americans live in areas where the air is officially classified as unhealthy to breathe.
It's a big world, and it's been here a long time.
Yeah, we're talking years and years and years.
The Center for Disease Control says that 94,000 people get sick every year from contaminated water. 900 of those people die.
It's all in their heads.
It's media hype.
The average American dumps at least 20 pounds of household toxins down the drain every year, most of which ends up in the drinking water supply.
Personally, I drink tap water. I mean, it's not like we're in Bangladesh.
Personally, I feel fine. I mean, I ask you, seriously, who's really getting hurt here?
5.8 million children died last year as a result of unsafe drinking water.
Not me, or my kids, right, Billy? Billy, where are you?
Can one person make a difference? Today, 66% of our rivers and lakes are safe for fishing and swimming. A third more than in 1970. One person can make a difference. A message from Echo, the Earth Communications Office.
And now, Vince and Larry, the crash test dummies with a lullaby.
Crumple, crumple, little car, when you crash, it's au revoir.
If on dumb luck you rely, through the windshield they will fly.
Keep your children off the streets.
Put your kids in safety seats.
Crumple, crumple, little car, don't be dummies like we are.
Gee, Vince, I'm kind of sleepy now.
Okay, Larry, just crash anywhere.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your kids' safety belts. A message from the Department of Transportation and the Ad Council.
Oh, come on, have a drink.
No, thanks.
Just one little drink.
I don't want to.
Chicken, everyone else is.
I said no.
What a nerd. One little drink won't kill you.
You've heard it all before. Be cool, join the crowd, have a drink, even though you're not 21.
Let's go, she's no fun.
Make the right choice, don't give in. Underage drinking is dumb and dangerous.
Look out!
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Hey, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam Perola. That is Dr. Drew over there.
What do you think about that strategy, though, of telling the Culver City PD you do 65 down Culver?
Quite down. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Alfonso and Saul are here. They're from Jaguares. We'll hear something else from them before the night is through.
But first, we got to finish this popcorn bucket scenario. People have waited since last night to hear
okay.
this.
All right. Here's the story, and I hope we're not boring the guys. This kind of humor crosses all international boundaries. It's it's what we call poop humor. There was a time in my life when I was sort of banished to the garage. I lived
by an evil stepmother.
Yeah, and my dad had a part of it,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, but we have not bashed your stepmother at all, ever.
Okay,
your,
we
your
should
grandmother's
bash her,
got
too.
Your nailed, your mom's gotten nailed.
Right.
You've never said anything
right.
about your
as family. I've said to my family a thousand times, you guys rolled the dice and came up snake eyes when it came to me getting a radio show. My poor son of a bitch parents never thought I'd get myself a radio show, and now it's payback time. And the whole nation can know
so
what crappy parents they were. It's time for
revenge.
Yes.
Okay.
Those sons of bitches thought I'd be crawling under a house for the rest of my life and not telling anybody about what horrible parents they were. Well, now it's payback time. So I was forced, not forced, I lived out in the garage, which was sort of half converted into a room. No bathroom, no air conditioning, no heater, no nothing like that. But it was kind of a room. I lived out there when I was about 18, 19 years old. My stepmom was wanting me out of the house, which was ironic because I was already out of the goddamn house. I was in the garage. I was driving a beat-up motorcycle and working construction, and I didn't go into the house. As a matter of fact, I couldn't get into the house. I'd get locked out of the house after a certain certain time in the evening, 9
4
or 10 o'clock.
In the afternoon.
No, but my stepmom didn't like me too much.
No
I wasn't,
kidding.
I wasn't crazy about her, and I wouldn't go in the house, and she'd lock me out of the house.
You said, so, if you saw her in the window, you'd avoid. You'd wait till she walked into another part of the house.
Of course, and my dad is such a spineless wuss that he never, my dad is 100% pussy. 100% puss. He really is.
Point one.
Oh, he's one, if it went up to 101, that's what he would be. And he's so spineless, he never stood up to her, so she just bashed me around. So I was out in the garage, and what I did was, and I've told Drew this story before, I had a bar of soap that I would keep by the hose in the back, and I would shower, you know, it was during the summer, I was working construction, I'd come home, I'd be filthy dirty from digging all day, and I would shower with the hose, and so Drew was saying, well, where'd you pee? And I'd say, out in the bushes. But last night... And I don't know why you wanted to go down this road, Drew, but last night you asked about number two.
Yes.
Where did you go number two?
Yeah, what did you do for that? Because you said there was no bathroom and you couldn't get in the house. I thought, what the hell's going on here?
All right. Well, let me first qualify the statement before I explain where I went number two. A, it wasn't as if I ran home to cramp in a popcorn bucket. You understand?
I understand.
If I was at someone's house, I would use their toilet.
Yes.
You understand? Indeed. If I was at the job site, I'd use the porta potty or what have you.
Yes. That's right.
And technically, I could use the bathroom indoor with the plumbing before, let's say, 9, 10 o'clock at night.
Which you never did. You never went in the house.
Well, I was scared to go in there.
Yeah.
But at a certain point, if I was home and I had to go, my cousin, Vince and Pat Bruno, for Christmas earlier that year, they got me one of those big 5-gallon tubs of popcorn. You know, the metal tins. They have a snap lid on them. You guys have seen those. They're decorative. They're all sectioned off. They got the caramel, the cheese, and the butter one. Well, after I was done with that, I was looking at it, and I thought, hey, it's got a nice airtight snap lid on it. It's sturdy construction, and it's easy on the eyes. I mean, it has nice pictures of Santa Claus and Rudolph on the sides. Very festive, very festive. So I told Drew, much to, I think, his and Ann's horror.
I don't think, slept last night.
Just tossing and turning, thinking about the popcorn bucket I cramped in when I was 18. I told him I used to cramp in the popcorn bucket. Yeah.
Yeah, not just I did it.
Yeah.
But I did it, and I'd emptied every three visits.
I think I may have said two, but yeah, could have been three. Hey, it had a snap lid. Hey, Drew, what the hell did pioneers do?
They went somewhere a fair distance from where they slept, I suspect.
No. This was me against the elements, Drew.
This is amazing when a porta potty is like major, major luxury.
Oh, a porta potty to me was like Liberace's bathroom. It really was.
God. Oh, Anne, are you all right?
Yeah, snap a lid.
You okay? You can recover from the. Okay. Yeah.
All right.
She's okay.
All right. Are you done?
How would you dump it? We dump it in the pool? What pool?
The pool? Yeah, that's what I did. Well, I don't know. I'd go out and hose it out or something.
You'd hose it out in the backyard.
It was my bathroom. What'd you want me to do? You just crap on the floor? Well, my buddy Ray did crap on the floor once just as a joke, and my dad did walk in and find it, by the way. That was a good one. But by then, we were so far gone, it didn't matter anymore.
I swear to God, the chimpanzees have better hygiene.
Drew,
the Holly Mountains.
What would you have done? What would you have done? I ask you. I'll ask Jaguares. What would you have done? You'd have to do it. What are your choices? You have no choices. Yeah?
I don't know. Dig a hole.
Dig a hole? I couldn't dig a hole. Then my stepmom would have thrown me in it and buried it. Buried me.
All right.
Should have seen that as a golden grave opportunity.
Again, back to the evil stepmom.
You can buy big pampers.
I don't blame you.
big pampers
and tens. I blame her.
You blame my stepmom?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, she was bad. Yeah, no doubt about it. All right. Michael?
Yeah.
You're 30?
Yes.
What's up?
How's it going?
Good.
I had a question regarding heroin. I started the use of it about 9 years ago, and I was smoking it.
Mm-hmm.
And what the effects of aluminum foil have on your body, because I've heard of, Alzheimer's and different things that...
Are you off the heroin now?
Yes, I am.
You're in recovery.
Actually, I'm in recovery.
Great.
How many people smoke heroin these days?
It's probably a little less common right now, but it was going through a big, big resurgence for the last couple of years.
Really?
It's actually not that common at all. I mean, most people either snort it or inject it.
Thank you very much.
I was dealing with a lot of people who smoked it for a while.
You saw two guys in 8 years who did it.
No. It was for a while there, particularly like college age, where they say, hey, I'm just smoking.
What's the best
deal.
Way to smoke it?
Well, you put it on aluminum foil, and you let it drip down, and, the smoke comes up, and you suck it in.
What do you mean you let it drip down?
Well, it melts down the foil. It's called chasing the dragon.
Oh, it melts the foil? You mean it has
it drips down.
Well, the foil doesn't melt, but the heroin on the foil melts down. It makes like a trail.
After you put a flame under it, right?
Yeah. Exactly.
You put it on the foil, and it drips down. Is that a great explanation? Now, you got to get the fire worked in there. Yeah.
See, in California, it's black tar on the West Coast. It's black tar heroin on the East Coast. You got, China White.
There's no evidence that I know of that anything significant happens from that kind of aluminum exposure, if any aluminum exposure
All right,
is significant.
Michael? If it makes you feel any better, I've smoked a pot out of a Coke can many a time.
The Alzheimer connection is very weak, very weak. There are plenty of people who walk around with extraordinarily high aluminum levels, even to the point of having their bones chelated with aluminum that weakens their bones. All kinds of things can go on. Those people do not get dementia.
Yeah, this was something that was talked about some years ago, and then it was sort of disproved
a
little
bit.
Is it back?
It's back and forth.
All right.
It's the fact that there's aluminum depositions in these scars that basically form in the process of Alzheimer's doesn't have anything to do with causation.
Drew, you were more exciting to the listeners when you were speaking in French. You understand? All right. Jaguares is our guest tonight. We're going to take ourselves a little break. When we come back, we'll speak. Drew, start doing your job here.
Let's see.
No, please.
Talk about the band.
No, yeah. Come on. You got to give me a good butt question. That's a horrible question. All right, we'll be back with a good one after this.
LoveLine will be right back. LoveLine will be right back.
These are the sounds of today's kids. And these are the voices of today's kids.
Don't underestimate me. I can work harder in school.
Give me a problem that's hard to solve.
Give me tougher work. Give me tougher books.
When I solve a tough problem, I'm on top of the world.
Surprised? Don't be. 74% of kids say schools should only pass them to the next grade when they've learned what's expected of them.
I'm not afraid to fail.
If I make a mistake, I'll do better next time.
75% of kids say they'd study harder if their schools gave them tougher tests. The fact is, almost all kids want to be challenged in school. So listen to the voices of kids today.
Challenge me.
Challenge me. Challenge me.
Do your part. Support higher academic achievement in your state and challenge our schools to challenge our kids. For a free booklet, call 1-800-38-BE-SMART. A message from the Ad Council and the Education Excellence Partnership.
Taking all that work home?
No, this is my own stuff. I've got a date with a financial planner.
You're only 25. Why are you planning for retirement already?
Hey, I want to be able to choose when I retire. And know that I'll be financially secure when I do.
I've heard lots of people call themselves financial planners, but aren't they really trying to get you to invest in their favorite fund? Like they're selling size 20 shoes so everyone gets a hello, Bigfoot.
Uh-uh. Half this stuff is my bank statements, company insurance policies, tax returns. The planner's going to know a lot about me before recommending anything. The rest is background information I've collected on her and two other planners. If she passes tonight's round, she gets my papers.
Securing your financial future is important. You have a right to expect financial advice that's competent, ethical, and based on your needs. To verify that a planner is certified, call toll-free 888-CFP-MARK. A public service of the Certified Financial Planner Board of Standards.
Hey, driving fans! It may have happened to you. You may have heard the roar of the rumble strips, the blast of car and truck horns, and the heart-pounding fear of a near miss. Avoid all the dangerous crash action that comes with falling asleep at the wheel. Experience the amazing power nap. You've never seen power like this before. The power nap. Find out what the professional drivers have been doing for years. The power nap gives you the energy you need for the road ahead, and it's free. Whether you're driving to the shore with your family, to another city to meet a client, to school across the state, or anywhere there's action. The power nap is your ticket to revitalization. Experience the power nap at a rest stop near you. Just pull in, find a safe, well-lighted spot to park, turn off the key, and close your eyes. In just 20 to 30 minutes, you'll have the energy you need to drive safely for miles. So don't push it, park it. And feel the power of the power nap. A wake-up call to all drivers from the U.S. Department of Transportation and the American Trucking Association.
It's nearly 6 a.m. and we're at a rest stop talking to travelers. Excuse me.
Yes.
Have you ever heard of circadian rhythms?
It's like a Latin band, right?
Not quite. Do you know what circadian rhythms are?
It's when the stars all align and their energy creates...
No. How about you, sir? Huh? Circadian rhythms. Exactly. Circadian rhythms tell your body when it should be sleeping as well as when it should be awake.
Huh?
Circadian rhythms are part of our body's internal controls, a kind of built-in clock that tells us when to wake up and when when to go to sleep each day. Imagine the danger that comes when we try to drive when our body thinks we should be sleeping, especially at night, early morning, and for many people, mid-afternoon. You really should try to avoid driving during your body's down times. If you have to drive when you'd normally be sleeping and you find yourself getting drowsy, stop for a refreshing 20 to 30 minute nap. Now what would you say when I say circadian rhythms?
I'd say, don't push it. Park it.
Right.
A wake-up call from the U.S. Department of Transportation and the American Trucking Associations.
Oh, come on, have a drink.
No, thanks.
Just one little drink.
I don't want to.
Chicken, everyone else is.
I said no.
What a nerd. One little drink won't kill you.
You've heard it all before. Be cool, join the crowd, have a drink, even though you're not 21.
Let's go, she's no fun.
Make the right choice. Don't give in. Underage drinking is dumb and dangerous. A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Nonviolence is not just a philosophy, but an active way of life. In an age marked by frequent acts of brutality and violence, we need to embrace those whose struggles are nonviolent. I'm Sharon Stone, asking you to take a stand for nonviolence by supporting those who remain dedicated to this vital form of conflict resolution. Call 1-888-MILAREPA, M-I-L-A-R-E-P-A, or log on to milarepa.org. Let's make nonviolence the way of the 21st century.
Yep, it is LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. We're here with Jaguares. Jaguares has sold themselves over a million of the albums that are currently out. Their latest album, which is something we'll hear something from in, sometime in this hour. 5 million over their career. Doing all right. We have Alfonso and Saul here from the band. I think this is their third time here. That's what I'm going with. Drew, you with me on that one?
Third time.
All right. Yeah. Saul thinks two, but I say three. Or as we say Trace.
That's la tercera vez.
That's right. Priscilla?
Asleep.
Really? Oh, she's been on hold for 84 minutes, almost an hour and a half. Priscilla.
Yeah.
Oh, hey,
yeah.
There you go, baby. You're 17. What's up?
Hi. Well, I lost my virginity like 4 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
And like a month and a half or 2 months after that, I like started getting these fainting spells. Like I was like out in the middle of the parking lot and I just like fainted right there. And I've done it 4 times. What's up with that?
Have you been evaluated for it?
Well, they took me to the hospital the first time and they did a bunch of tests and they didn't find nothing.
That the fact that you lost your virginity 2 months prior is sort of a spurious association.
Yeah.
There's nothing causative about that.
What do you think the chances of young Priscilla knowing what spurious or causative means?
None.
Okay. Spurious is like I'm trying to think of how to describe what that word means. It means neither here nor there. It's like as if you'd said, I was late for work. If you told your boss you were late to work because your toaster broke.
Not significant.
Right. Not probably not a factor.
Yeah.
Probably. So I know you're putting those two things together, but they're probably not connected.
Okay.
So.
Are you on new medication or anything?
No, not lately.
Are you on any medication?
No, I know.
And what did they say when you got the test?
They didn't say anything really. They like, I actually only saw the doctor once, and he said it was going to run some tests and some x-rays, and then I didn't see him again after that, and they just released me from the hospital.
Were you on medication at the time you passed out?
No.
Okay. Well, why don't you follow it back up again?
Had you been recently stopped on some medication at that point?
No. It was like 3 months
prior
before that when I stopped.
What medication?
Just like naproxen.
Just like naproxen?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks for having us have to ring you to get that piece of information out of you and devote half the show to it, Priscilla. We appreciate it.
Oh, okay.
All right. I hate Priscilla. I don't know why. Do you guys hate her too? I don't like her at all. Why do I dislike her so much?
There's a hostility running underneath.
There is? Yeah. Is that what that is? Yeah. I hate asking the same idiot the same question 10 times, which is what we do on this show. All right, so Drew, what should she do?
Follow through with her usual doctor. She had appropriate workup. She can finish. There's literally dozens and maybe even hundreds of different causes of this, most of which are not significant.
Not losing the virginity. Now, you lose your virginity, your dad faints,
right?
But not you.
That's right.
Is that how it works?
Sometimes your mom, sometimes your grandma.
That's right. That's right. And often another side effect of a virginity is a deceased grandparent could roll over in a his or her grave.
You've heard of that?
Yes, I have actually seen that. I remember
sometimes the forefathers.
When my sister lost her virginity, my grandmother from Philadelphia, who died 5-6 years prior to my sister losing her virginity,
from a Sarah?
Spun over in her grave. I remember hearing the creaking. She was a large woman, and we had her buried in the basement of the house. Brian,
hi.
You're 16. What's up?
First of all, I just want to say that I saw you on the Perry Kilborn show, and hilarious.
Thank you, Brian. Thanks
for
causing more trouble.
Yeah, the Screen Actors Guild thinks he was hilarious, too. They're still laughing.
All right. Go ahead there, Brian.
Well, my problem is that every once in a while I just have these bouts of depression. They only last usually a day or two, and I was just wondering what was causing them.
Well, puberty.
Yeah, you're 16. What happens? You have a little trouble motivating during those days?
Yeah, and my dad just says, what's going on? You seem like down in the dumps. And it's just like it only lasts like a day or two, and then I feel better. A
certain amount of that is normal. Keep an eye on it. Take care of yourself. Don't ignore these feelings, and certainly don't keep them to yourself if they start getting really severe. But consider what things might be sort of contributing to you falling into these depressive episodes.
Go on a walk.
Yeah, and get exercise, and you know, stay focused on doing things that are good for you and you want to do. But know that at 16, the biology is. Tends to send people into spiraling depression.
I think more people get depressed in this country.
Than where?
Mexico. than the rest of the world.
We have too much free time?
Yeah. You know what I think happens to Americans is we have it pretty good. We're used to things being pretty good. And when we don't feel good, it's a big deal. Yeah, I mean, if something goes wrong, it's a big deal. And if you take a look at other countries and most of the rest of the world, survival, day-to-day struggle.
Big deal.
You don't really have time for depression. Or your whole life is depressed and you don't notice it.
I think the other
thing. They get depressed in Mexico?
No, and also it's like que todo está acomodado. Todo tiene que estar bien. Everything has to be good.
Everything has to be all right.
I think also in this country we don't, our family systems are so screwed
and so systematic situation here.
The
also.
Whole system,
yeah, the whole system. You know, like have to be like online. If it's a little broke, you are in trouble.
It's a disaster.
We grown up like with no line. I mean, it's
in Mexico.
Different idiosyncrasy.
You're saying in Mexico they do or don't have all this health care and all this stuff.
No, he's talking about the way people here are more like have a direction. Everything has to be a certain way.
Right.
And in Mexico, it's more chaotic. I think that's what he was trying to say.
You mean...
sort of.
We mean like here it's like get an education, get your degree, graduate from college, become a lawyer. I mean, there's a lot of pressure. A lot of kids are forced in a direction. Whereas other parts of the world, it's maybe a little, well, except for like Japan and
Japan
maybe China.
Is a big problem.
Yeah, but I bet they're pretty depressed over there. You know what I mean? Hey, listen, I just came back from Jamaica. No one's depressed over there. They're just high, and their motto is just...
hang loose.
Yeah, no, it's not hang loose. Those are the Hawaiians, yeah. Or by the way, also high.
and happy.
Yeah, the more pot that seems to be in the culture and the closer the beach, the less the depression. Now, here's Jamaica's. No problem, man. I mean, you know, we're just a bunch of white guys from Hollywood. And it's like, where, when's the flight? Where is it? No problem. And it's just everything's just no problem. Just have a drag off a joint. No problem. Take your shoes off.
But I think here our connections, the family systems are so weak and so poor that we don't have sort of the usual internal resources and family resources to make ourselves feel better.
Yeah, there's some isolation.
Isolation, disconnect, lack of sort of development emotionally. I've traveled a little bit in Mexico, and I remember seeing, you know, although I'll see lots of poverty, lots of happiness.
Mm-hmm.
They have families together, doing things. I mean, they don't have anything, but happy. And maybe
that's true. I mean, the unity of the family there is so important.
Very tight. And here
strong.
It's like,
well, you got 40 people in one room. You better be tight. I can't go to my
but
parents.
You better be happy.
Yeah. I saw circumstance after circumstance in that country where people would have been, oh my God, lamenting that anybody could live like that. They're fine.
Well,
put
it this way. The overwhelming majority of Americans between the age of 15 and 40 look at their parents as a pain in the ass. And Drew, I know I not only speak from personal experience, but I know you have certain feelings about your parents. You don't want to go camping with them, do you?
No camping.
I mean, you go over there twice a year, Easter and Thanksgiving, you've had an ass full, right? Could you imagine moving back home or something like that?
Right.
All right, so here's the point. In what other country does the average adult look at their sort of aging parents as a pain in the ass?
Not. Yeah,
I think only United States.
It's the United States,
and that's why this is the greatest country in the world. Don't ever forget it. We not only neglect the elderly, we abuse them. Oh, boy. What is that?
Rogelio.
Yeah, what's up?
Hey, you're 26. What's up?
I have a question for Jaguares, actually, for Saul and Alfonso.
Great.
Is that all right?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right. ¿Cómo están, compas?
Bien, muy bien. ¿Y tú?
Muy bien, gracias.
Okay, they said, how are you? And he said, fine. Okay, Drew?
I got
That's
it.
Right.
Okay.
My question, one of my favorite songs, Las Ratas No Tienen Alas, what is the meaning? What's the significado behind that? What is that about?
Es una crítica al gobierno, al sistema político.
Criticism to the system, the political system in Mexico.
De traición.
Yeah.
Talks about betrayal.
Y bueno, like rats, como ratas, pues no pueden volar.
Is that why you guys don't trust the new system that's in? You just figure it's more of the same?
Well, that song was really in the old system.
Right.
Yeah.
But I don't know what is going to happen in the new system.
Yeah.
Maybe we have to write like the new rats also doesn't have wings.
Right.
I don't know.
Right. You have any other?
Let's hope not.
Any other questions for Jaguares?
Not so much questions, just wanted to say muchas gracias for your inspiration, because of you guys, I play the drums now, and I also write poetry, thanks to Alfonso and Saul, and nomás, viva el jaguar y viva el rock.
Ah, muchas gracias, Rogelio.
Thank you, Rogelio.
Thank you.
Take care of yourself there. All right. Is that a common name? I never heard that name.
Yeah.
It is?
Rogelio. Yeah.
Rogelio?
In Mexico is common.
Yeah. Really? Name one famous Rogelio, you know, is in the big leagues or...
Rogelio Gonzalez.
In baseball.
No. Nice try. Alfonso, now there's a name. Stacy?
Yeah.
You're 15?
Yeah.
What's up?
I was wondering how I should tell my parents that I'm choosing to become sexually active.
Huh. The way you asked that made us suspicious already.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why do you want to have that talk with them?
Because I want to be honest with them.
Uh-oh.
Why? Why is that important if that's something you're choosing to do? Not that I object to it. I think it's a great idea, but just sort of the energy.
We don't trust you.
Yeah, the energy you have behind it doesn't sound right to me.
Because my parents have always told me that
sex is bad.
If I decide to do anything, I can tell them, and that they can get me birth control and condoms and protection.
All right.
Are they
sound too bad?
Have they otherwise been sort of energetic in their attempts to educate you about the harms and the ills of sexual activity?
I don't know. I just want to know how I should bring the topic up.
Ask the question again.
All right, hold on. Stacy, we're just trying to figure out what the motivation is. You love your parents?
Yeah.
That didn't sound like a ringing endorsement.
Yeah.
Do you love your parents?
For the most part.
All right. So there's parts you're mad at them for some reason?
Where have they been a pain in the ass?
Don't really know. It's just...
What?
My stepmom is kind of...
Makes you cramp in a popcorn tin? Is that what happened? Honey, I feel your pain.
My stepmom's just kind of...
Who knows what the long-term medical repercussions of me sitting on that sharp metal rim were for so many months.
No wonder you sit around letting your farts now. It's probably the only way to amuse yourself.
That's right. It's my way of coping. Stacy, who are you mad at? Your dad or your stepmom? Who are you angry at?
Uh-oh.
Is that dad? Okay. Hey, Stacy, you want me to tell him? We'll tell him right now.
Okay. Yeah.
Oops.
Stacy?
Yeah.
Now, you just missed a golden opportunity. Drew could have really had a sit down with dad.
No.
Oh, I thought you wanted to tell him. Listen, if Drew says it's okay, it's okay. You could probably, he'll go out and get you a male prostitute if Drew says okay. So, Stacy, who are you mad at? Your stepmom or your dad?
Or your real mom.
Or your real mom.
My real mom.
Why, okay. Why are you mad at her?
What'd she do? Abandon you? Leave you with the evil stepmom?
It's a long story.
Okay. Well, see ya. Let's just move on. Cecilia?
Yes.
Listen, I don't want to sit there and play 20 questions with some prepubescent teen. Screw you. I don't want to sit there and drag her. Screw you. Go ahead. Have sex. Tell your dad. Well, here's what you do. Write it in shaving cream on the mirror. I'm getting laid.
All right. The point is, though,
see you in the morning.
Your choice in doing this is driven by your desire to get back at your mom.
Of course. I mean, okay, listen, let's just talk about this for a second. Here's what I've learned on my 5 years here at Loveline. People think the truth is very noble, and you can never go wrong if you tell the truth. And we
probably
put a
true.
Lot of emphasis on this as a society. And whenever you talk about founding fathers or noblemen or gentlemen, it's always talking about integrity and truth. But when people tell people the truth, I found on this show, they have less than philanthropic reasons for doing it.
Let's put it this way. When adolescents tell their parents and partners, male, female, or male-male partners tell each other something, there's motivation. It's not the truth. It's motivating them.
Right. So she wanted to tell her parents she was going to become sexually active, which sounds great. And we questioned her, and she said, well, they always said come to us first, and we'll get you on birth control, and we'll get you condoms. But it still sounded a little suspicious. And as we scratch beneath the surface, it turns out she's angry, and it's ready to sort of screw you time for mom. And listen, especially women. Women are very vengeful, spiteful creatures. They really are. Men would be, but they're fixated with their penis, and they have sports, and they're basically busy running the country. Women have plenty of time to sort of plot and scheme. They're like mad scientists, all women. All women have a little mad scientist in them, you know? And that's how come, that's where the problem comes in relationships. Men don't know what's going on. They're too busy going to work and rooting for the Dodgers. And women are down. They're hard at work in the lab. They really are. So here's what I'm saying. All you people that have young daughters especially, don't screw with them. They will screw with you one day. You're a dad, you don't pay attention to your young daughter, you drink a little too much, you physically abuse her, don't worry. It'll be payback time
soon. Yeah, that's true.
She'll become a prostitute, she'll do a couple of porn movies. You can have a good time going back to work at the plant with all the guys on the assembly line who have a couple of porn tapes starring your daughter. There will be payback time. And
well, they can make a business together.
They certainly can. And she's 15, and it's time to pay him back. So if I was, what the hell was her name? Miss Bitterman. She should just sit on that. Don't get pregnant. Get your birth control. But when you tell your parents, tell them because you want to tell them.
Because you want to share it. Yeah.
Because you want to share it, not because it's payback time. Cecilia?
Yeah?
You're 20. What's up?
Okay. I have a question for Los Jaguares.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I just want to know qué significa el symbol que tienes en el primero CD.
Perdón?
El symbol?
The symbol in your first CD.
Ah, the symbol. Es un cazador.
It's un cazador.
What? A hunter?
I see. The symbol.
To de la época.
Right, the one I don't have in front of me. That's right.
Prehispánica.
Right. I think we got into that one time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This thing.
The logo, the Jaguares. If Jaguares was a baseball team, this is what would be on their hat.
Yes.
Right.
I have another question.
And I'll tell you what it means in Spanish. Pot plant. That's what this thing looks like.
It's a hunter, come on.
Oh, it's a hunter, right. The guy's hunting for a pot plant. You see what
for a joint.
What else, okay. Cecilia?
Looks like a Dr. Seuss character.
I just
want to
know, when are they going to be touring in Tijuana?
Ah, pues el año que entra, probablemente, porque ahora estamos de vacaciones.
Uh-huh. Oh, yes. Are you going to play Tijuana? You
yeah,
play Tijuana?
Next year.
Where do you play in Tijuana? You play that high life? No, dome they got over there?
In the theater, no? In,
no, there's a bullfight ring that we play there.
Y en una explanada que es enorme.
And a big...
you guys know Tijuana
place,
well?
No, yeah, it's great.
Yeah.
It's great.
Revolution.
Tijuana is great.
Avenue and Tijuana Tilly's and... oh, what's my... the Unicorn Bar. That's a good nudie bar. Underneath Revolution Avenue. Guys perform oral sex on women on stage.
Guys, like for the audience?
Yes, these aren't professionals. These are drunken Marines.
Oh, my God.
Well, at least that's how it went when I was younger.
It's a heavy place. Yeah.
It's a good time, though. Yeah, you know, the thing about...
Enjoy.
No, you hang out in Tijuana for a little while, and then you go to Ensenada. It's boring. Tijuana or Rosarita or something.
Alguno de los padres que estaba diciendo pueden ir a ver a Tijuana, darse un rol para que vean qué puede pasar.
Yeah.
Yeah, so those parents can go and check out what... could happen, yeah.
Yes, that's right. All you bad fathers, go to Tijuana. See where your daughter's first place of employment will be. Lorena?
Yes?
You're 22?
Good times.
Yes, I am.
What's up?
I have a question for Saul, or actually I want to tell Saul something.
Uh-huh.
Saul, hi, my name is Lorena. I just wanted to let you know that I am from here. I was born here. I really got into your music a couple years ago. I do not speak the language at all. I love everything about Jaguares. I've been to every single one of your concerts in the past 2 years, every single one of them, all the way to Vegas, going to Chicago. I just wanted to let you know that you don't know what you do to the local scene that's out here, the local rock scene. I'm involved with a lot of local rock bands.
Where are you?
I live in Covina.
Where?
I live in Covina.
Oh, Covina.
But yeah, in Covina. It's like 20 minutes from L.A. But everywhere I go is in L.A.
Covina is a Spanish word meaning crap hole.
Oh, God. Don't leave my
It's very true. It's true. So we'll dump that Covina.
Only to be exceeded by West Covina.
All yeah. Your major fans are right uh-huh. outside the building.
Oh, thank you.
Wow.
And we love you so much.
Oh, thank you.
Where are you?
Hold on. What do you got going over there?
You have a party there?
Where? Yeah, pizza here. You guys want some? I ordered some.
What kind of place are you in?
What was that?
Where are you? What kind of place are you in?
What kind of place?
In the parking
okay,
lot.
Hold on a
Wait
second.
Wait a minute. Is it a restaurant?
Look,
are you a
phone booth? I like the band, but their fans aren't real smart.
Wait, let's try again. Are you in a phone booth? Where are you?
No, I'm on my cell phone. I'm wasting like...
Wait.
I've been on...
Where are you?
We're right out front. Look out your door.
Okay. Oh, they're right here. They're here. They're not in Covina.
Okay.
All right, please.
Culver City right now.
All right,
okay.
Listen.
Okay.
Let's get the Culver City PD back here.
Yeah, please.
Fire a couple of concussion grenades into the crowd. They'll scatter. Drew, you cover me. I'll make a break for my car, right?
All right, I'm ready. And go.
No, I saw them all. They're all out here out in the parking lot by the van. All right, listen.
I thought those were all people picketing your
Why don't let's go say hi to them.
All right.
I'm going to do that. Hold on a second.
Lorena.
Hey, Lorena.
Yeah, I'm here.
Do you have any food?
Yes, we have pizza.
Oh, do you? What kind?
We have pepperoni and pineapple.
Oh, pineapple. Yeah.
Got it there.
Hey, settle down. Settle down.
Pepperoni and sausage and ham.
Do you have thin crust?
What?
Is it thin crust?
Yes, it's thin crust.
Okay, I'll be there in a minute.
Okay, he's going to be there.
The band is not. No, the band isn't coming. I'm coming.
He's going for the pizza.
Are you talking to those guys?
Huh?
Hey, who do you want to say hi to?
The curanderos, I want to say hi to Nephilim, I want to say hi to...
Okay. All right. Well, it's not American Bandstand. All right, and don't anyone do anything weird to that pizza. I'm coming out there right now.
Okay, come get pizza.
All right, we'll see you in a second. All right, I'm going to be back with some tainted pizza and Jaguares after this.
Hello, this is your radio. LoveLine will be right back.
Who ever heard of finding out if you're pregnant or not before you even miss your period? Well, now you can, because now there's the First Response Early Result Pregnancy Test. Based on product instructions, you can use First Response 4 days earlier than any other at-home test.
Use as directed. See your doctor as recommended.
Just think, it's like knowing what you're doing for the rest of your life 4 days sooner.
Find out first with First Response.
Look in the mirror. See anything unusual? Look closer. There's actually a bacteria party going on right inside your pores. With a guy charging cover and a really long wait. If you're bacteria, this is the place to be.
I'm on the guest list.
Luckily, there are Biore pore strips to put an end to this never-ending party. Weekly use of Biore strips removes bacteria and other nasty stuff before they lead to complexion problems. Remember, just because you can't see it doesn't mean it's not there. Biore Pore Perfect Strips. Clean. Honest.
Hi, I'm Serenity, and these are my friends, Missy and Stephanie.
You know, a lot of things happen to us every day that we have no control over.
But HIV and other sexually transmitted diseases aren't things that just happen to you. You do have a choice. You can choose to use a condom, have safe sex, and take control of your life.
Asking for a condom isn't stupid. It's smart. It shows that you care about yourself and your partner.
You can do something about sexually transmitted diseases.
Use a condom. Every partner.
Every time.
We do.
A message brought to you by Wicked Pictures and AIDS Project Los Angeles.
Oh, come on, have a drink.
No, thanks.
Just one little drink.
I don't want to.
Chicken, everyone else is.
I said no.
What a nerd. One little drink won't kill you.
You've heard it all before. Be cool, join the crowd, have a drink, even though you're not 21.
Let's go, she's no fun.
Make the right choice. Don't give in. Underage drinking is dumb and dangerous.
Look out!
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Somewhere in our community is a mother whose drug abuse once left her unable to care for her kids. There's a father, too, whose alcohol use drove his wife and children away. There's a boyfriend whose drug use frightened his girlfriend into giving him an ultimatum: get help or I'm gone. Help is available. It's in the form of treatment programs for drug abuse and alcohol problems. And the good news is that these programs are making a big difference in people's lives. With proper treatment, mothers and fathers, sweethearts and coworkers, friends and neighbors are overcoming drug and alcohol problems and reclaiming their lives. Isn't it great that treatment works? To find out about drug and alcohol treatment programs that can help, call 1-800-662-HELP. That's 1-800-662-HELP. There is help, and it works. A public service of this station and the Center for Substance Abuse Treatment.
Dad, I don't think our campfire's totally out.
Are you kidding me? I know when a campfire's out.
Did you drown the fire with water and stir it with a stick?
No, it's out. We don't have to... Who said that?
Frank, it's a talking moose with sunglasses.
And a bunch of singing and dancing forest animals.
We know we can count on you to do what Smokey says.
And when your folks desire to build a fire.
Hot, hot.
Clear brush and branches away.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And keep water nearby like you oughta.
We're all counting on you.
Okay, I poured water on the fire. I stirred it with a stick. Everybody walked slowly toward the RV.
Dad, these are just Smokey's friends.
Only you can prevent forest fires.
Frank, it's Smokey.
Nice hat, Smokey. Want the rest of my peanut butter sandwich?
Dad!
Visit Smokey at www.smokeybear.com. Brought to you by the USDA Forest Service, the National Association of State Foresters, and the Ad Council.
Yeah, it's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Alfonso and Saul are both here from Jaguares. They have rambunctious fans that have camped out in the parking lot. And I just went out there and ate myself a nice slice of pizza, and so did Engineer Anderson. We're keeping it real here. I've said it many a time. Somebody sent some homemade popcorn balls over here. I ate three of them the other night.
And they were awful.
I still ate three of them. And my point is
you like popcorn, huh?
No, my point is you, if someone sent me anything, even if it looks like they made it in their driveway, I would eat it. That's I'm a man of the people, right, Drew?
Yeah, you are. When you're hungry.
You understand? There's other B/C celebrities that would never do that. They would have someone taste it for them. They would think it was poison. Not me. I trust the people. Anyway, you guys got to go out there and say hi to those people at some point.
Yeah, we already did.
You already did?
Yeah, we take pictures and...
Yeah, they want to see you again.
A lot of things we do before we...
They own Adam now. They've given him pizza.
They're all wearing the Jaguares shirts. That one girl has the tattoo of the Jaguares pot plant symbol on the back of her neck.
Yeah, the back of her neck.
Yeah, that's love. Drew has a Cheap Trick tattoo on his back, but that was many years ago. Drew?
Yeah, this is a Dr. Seuss character.
I see. Yeah, that's very, very clever, Drew. Fernando?
Hey, what's up? How's it going?
You're 18?
Yeah.
What's up?
I have a question for the Jaguares first.
All right.
¿Qué onda, compas? ¿Cómo están?
Bien, bien.
I was wondering...
Said good, good.
I was wondering if you guys are going to come up north to, like, to Oakland or San Francisco maybe next year?
We will.
Cool, cool.
Where's sure. the big? Where's it biggest for you guys in the States? Los Angeles?
Here in the States, I guess, around the area of Los Angeles.
But what is second? Chicago's New York?
Texas.
Very big.
Oh, Texas, yeah. Yeah, I could see that being a
Chicago,
good place.
I think, is the second one.
Oh, really? Over Texas?
That's interesting, yeah.
And also have another question.
What the hell are they getting over there, Drew?
Fernando, go ahead.
Yeah.
I just want to thank you guys, Adam and Dr. Drew, for you guys, having a great show. I know it must be hard for you sometimes for, like, getting all the weird people, but it's really good that we have people like you.
Oh, thanks.
Give advice.
Thank you.
And I love the Man Show. You're great. I think you should adopt that little kid, the little Cub Scout kid.
Oh, yes, Aaron, the Man Show boy.
Oh, yeah, you got to adopt that kid. I mean,
yeah, he's...
He should be your kid right there, man.
His mom would appreciate that.
Thanks, Fernando. He's homeschooled, by the way. So it's a little Man Show bit. This is in reference to Aaron, the Man Show boy, who we have go out and do our bidding for us.
Saw him yesterday trying to get somebody to buy beer for him outside of a liquor store.
That was my idea.
Come on, don't be such a pussy.
It was great. We took this 11-year-old kid who's about 200 pounds.
Yeah.
He's a big boy. He's short and he's lily white. He wears a Cub Scout uniform, and we sent him out to try to buy beer, try to get someone to buy you beer. Mm-hmm. And lo and behold, a guy eventually did buy him beer. It was not set up. It was great. He was like, "What do you want? What do you want?" And he was like, "Huh? 6-pack or 12-pack?" And the thing that was funny is the guy was in a rush.
Yeah, let's go.
It was kind of funny. Like, let's go. Okay, what do you want? And like, I don't know if you want a domestic or imported. What is the legal drinking age in Mexico? 18? Do they have one?
Yes, 18.
How is it? Is it enforced? I mean, when you were 15, could you go to the liquor store?
You cannot buy cigarettes or booze, but I guess you can.
Right.
It's the same as with the cops. You can
grease someone's palm.
Yeah.
I like that. I mean, now that I have money, I wish we lived in a society where you could do a little palm greasing. You know what I'm saying, Drew?
And they just send the police in to buy the beer for them.
Well, what I mean is you get pulled over, right? Mm. Do you feel like a criminal? Do you know what I mean? Do you feel like you need a lesson taught to you? Wouldn't you know it's a big hassle. You know it's going on your driving record. Wouldn't you love just to be able to pull $100 out of your wallet and hand it to the guy? And furthermore, Drew, how fast would you do that if you got pulled over?
It doesn't sound
how
like
fast?
Fast. It doesn't sound like a great idea for the society at large, though.
Look at Mexico. It's a utopia. What are you talking about?
Yeah, sure.
You're going to the airport. You don't want the guy to check a certain bag. You give him $20. You keep walking, right? Please. How dare you make fun of Mexico, Drew? Is this... Armstrong, Sergeant Armstrong?
Yes, sir.
What's up there, Sarge? Oh, wait.
Yes, sir?
Yes, you're 28.
Yes, sir.
Oof.
Yes, sir.
Get on your knees, scumbag!
A little Full Metal Jacket for you there. What's up, Sarge?
Well, I was in a... I can't disclose the location, but I was in a area where a lot of sand was. About 3 weeks later, after coming back stateside, I developed a rash in my groin area.
I see.
I went to the VA, and they told me it was nothing but mere heat rash and go away in a week.
Mm-hmm. Fungus.
Yeah, consequently, it did not.
Did you take a fungus cream?
Do I do what?
Did you use a fungus cream?
No, sir. I didn't know it was a fungus at the time. It's now gotten to the size about, you split a baseball in half and put it on both sides of the growing on both sides.
Yeah, go get yourself some...
antifungal, right?
Yeah.
What kind of stuff?
Oh, there's some good ones out there now. Lotrimin will work, Micotin will work.
Just spray the junk.
I'll tell you
there.
What, the Lamisil is the one you want. Go ahead and get the Lamisil over the counter.
Does the fungus usually react fairly violent against sweat and other?
Yeah, it's called jock itch.
Yeah.
That's what jock itch is.
Let me explain something, Sergeant Fungus, which would be a good wrestling name, by the way. here's the deal. Your groin, your nut sack, it's like a dinner roll. Okay. It's like a piece of bread. And you take that piece of bread and you sprinkle water on it, and then you put a glass over it, and you put it out in the sun, and you get heat, and you get moisture, and you get a sort of greenhouse effect. Well, in a couple days, what do you got on that bread?
Mold.
You got mold.
Penicillin.
You got stuff growing all over that bread. But you take that same roll, you put it out in the sun with the wind blowing, and what do you got?
Dry bone.
Well, you got
dry
mold.
Bread.
Yeah, wait, bread. No, it's a horrible point.
Old bread.
The point is a rat eats it, okay? So what's worse? Mold on your nuts or a rat devouring your scrotum sack? I think I've made my point. No, here's the deal. You want to dry something out, you gotta free ball it a little bit. You got to dump some powder down there. You got to spray that Micodin or that Desinex or whatever, that Lamisil.
Yep.
You got to keep it dry. If it's a moist, wet, warm environment, the mold is gonna propagate. Is that a good word there, Drew?
Beautiful.
Thank you. Yeah, unless you got to dry everything out. I'll tell you, like, for instance, you get a cut, you put a Band-Aid on it, you leave that Band-Aid on for 2 weeks, you pull the Band-Aid off, it looks like you got the cut 10 minutes ago.
Yeah.
You got to air it out. That's what heals everything. Blow wind on it. I'll put a fan down my pants a couple times a day just to air it out, just to ventilate.
Is that what you're doing?
Yeah, I'm now putting a fan down my pants. Thank you. Jaime? You're either Jewish or Mexican. Which one?
Mexican.
Okay, good, because that'd be a horrible name for a Jew. Kind of cruel parents would those be? That'd be funny if you named your kid Jaime. Your Jewish family?
Isn't there some joke with, like, Jaime Town or something like that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I haven't heard of him too much. But that's right. I'm Mexican, though, so.
Yeah.
It's all right. I had a question for Jaguares.
¿Qué pasó?
Alfonso, Saúl, buenas noches.
Hola, buenas noches.
What's up? So good evening.
About the new song they have on the Mission Impossible 2 soundtrack only came out on, like, the Latin American edition.
Yes.
So I was wondering if that was going to be available in the United States.
It's going to be in a new CD that's coming out with some songs from the history of the band, from Jaguares. And this song and another song that Saúl did with...
Chef Caleb.
What's his name? Chef Caleb.
So it'll be on a Jaguares, like, compilation.
Compilation, yes. That's going to be
August.
Released here in August.
All right, Jaime?
Okay, great. I'd like to ask him one more question.
Sure.
I know Alfonso plays with a band called La Barranca.
Yes.
And I was wondering, what does Jaguares do when he goes off and plays with them? Do you agarra otro que toca batería, or do you kind of guys just take a vacation and... So we'll start writing, or how does that work?
No, La Barranca has another drummer that plays when I cannot make it.
So but what does Jaguares do when you can't make it?
I can always make it.
Oh, okay.
Jaguares.
Well, there you go, honey.
Okay, thanks a lot, guys. You guys are a great band. Thank you.
Yeah, that's called, in Spanish, it's called prioritizia. Priority.
Priorities.
Priorities. There you go. True. You know,
prioridades
in Spanish. The Mexicans, they rip off all our big words. And they
parking.
Try to make it their own, like a dictionary. Like, how do you say dictionary?
Dictionario.
There you go. Stole another one of our
that's
good
words.
That's
the other way around.
They steal the big
parking
one.
Lot.
Parking lot?
Estacionamiento.
No,
that's a different one. It's better estacionamiento.
Like parking.
Sure, what
parking.
The hell kind of point are you trying
in
to make
French, they
over
say
there?
Parking.
Hypochondriac. How do you say that?
Hipocondriaco.
There you go. See, you put the O at the end, like it's all of a sudden, like you made it up. Mm-hmm. Please, who are you fooling? That's our word. You guys start making up your own words.
That's the other way around, actually. Those are Latin words, and our language comes from Latin directly.
Right, let's
so.
Not confuse this with the truth. I was on a roll. Drew, any more parking lot references you'd like to make, or can we go to commercial?
Let's go.
All right.
Hello, this is your radio. Love Line will be right back. This is a story about American heroes. They changed quite a few lives last year. Jorge Vasquez put out fires, but no, he's not a firefighter. Philip Dale discovered several new stars. Oh, he's not an astronomer. And Elaine Capobianco, she saved a child from drowning, but she's not a lifeguard. They're teachers, but to the kids they've reached, they're heroes.
I'm a teacher. The children are the heroes.
We're not just teaching subject matter, we're teaching human beings.
I am tough as nails, but they know that I love them.
I mean, we've got a legacy that follows behind us forever.
Teachers have the power to make an impact on our future. California will need about 250,000 more of them in the next 10 years. Reach for that power. Teach. Call 1-888-CAL-TEACH now. A public service message brought to you by CalTeach, the Ad Council, and this station.
Okay, so I'm a teenager, right? And everyone's so quick to judge me. On the outside, I may look like... But on the inside, I'm all...
Feeling. Whoa, 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 feeling.
Just because I look like... doesn't mean I act that way. In fact, I'm actually involved in crime prevention. That sounds more like this. It's really a great way to convince adults that while you may be looking, you're really thinking.
Call 1-800-722-TEENS to find out how to make your community a safer place for everyone. Get involved. Get the number and call. 1-800-722-TEENS. A public service message from the Crime Prevention Coalition of America, the U.S. Department of Justice, and the Ad Council.
Evening, folks. I'm Vince.
And I'm Larry. We're the Crash Test Dummies.
We'd like to entertain you with a little song. Only one thing.
We can't sing. But we're here with someone who can, with a song for the little ones. Ray?
Mr. Charles?
On the big highway of life, there's only one safe place for kids.
Backseat, baby.
The front seat's not the place to drop out. That booty's in the backseat.
Backseat, baby.
Airbags and kids you never meet. I'm here to remind you to put them behind you.
Raimondo, do you mind if we try?
Wow.
Backseat, baby, better buckled in the back.
Backseat, baby.
Baby faces stay intact.
Larry, wow. Yo, Larry, maybe you should keep your day job.
Ow, that hurts.
Not as much as our day job.
Even when I drive.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your kids in the back seat. A message from the Department of Transportation and the Ad Council.
Dear Jim, I just wanted to tell you the things I love so much about you. Like your pasty white belly and how it fits in those tight shirts that my friends think you shouldn't be wearing. I love how you do that thing where you mash four slices of bread into a massive ball of dough and stuff it in your mouth. That's so adorable. And what about when you tell those same jokes from reruns that you've seen over and over again? They make me laugh every single time. Other guys play sports or go running or do something outside, but not you. You're different.
Guys, rest assured you will never in your life meet a girl like this.
P.S. I can't wait until we cuddle in front of pro wrestling all day this Saturday. I hear it's a steel cage Texas death match.
Get some exercise. Get up. Get out. A public service message brought to you by the Ad Council and the President's Council on Physical Fitness and Sports.
LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. We have Jaguares here tonight. Their CD is called Bajo el Azul de Todora Maravillas. Maestro?
Bajo el Azul de ¿cómo? Tu Misterio.
Wait, say that again.
Bajo el Azul de Tu Misterio. Under the Mystery of Your Blue or something like that would be the translation.
Oh, I see. All right. I was on a roll there, but I just kind of petered out at the end. Maybe I got a little excited.
Yeah, we're doing great.
I sound like I was calling a soccer match instead of giving the name
goal,
of the
goal,
CD.
Goal, 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 goal.
Oh, man. He must be. How much commercial? Where's that guy from? Is he from Mexico? The goal.
Nope.
Where's he from?
His Pasadena.
Pasadena?
His dad works with me.
He's a gringo?
I don't know.
No, he's Argentinian.
Talking about,
he's Argentinian. Maybe.
The guy at the soccer match who.
No, I think he's from Argentina.
At the World Cup, who goal, goal.
Half an hour.
Yeah, he has a hole in the boys, not like.
Imagine how many commercial endorsements he's getting back in his homeland of Argentina. All right, we will hear something from Jaguares off of Bajo el Sol de Carona para esto. And, oh boy, Drew, what's this one called?
Tureno.
Tureno?
Así es.
Yeah?
Tureno.
Tureno.
We'll be right back.
That is a little Jaguares off here, something called the Turreno. And that, of course, is off of the Baja Zula which means how blue
which means
are your eyes?
clear.
Yeah, it means blue eyes, right? Blue something with the blue?
Blue mystery in the something happening.
Oh, okay. All right. There you go. Another good one from Jaguares. Ryan?
Yes.
You're 16?
Yeah.
What's up?
I think my girlfriend cheated with my stepbrother, and I don't know. I don't know how to confront her with that.
Why do you believe that?
Why do I believe that? Well, her birthday was last Monday. Mm. She had a party, and she lives down in North Carolina. It's where I really live. I'm just up here visiting my mom, and I wanted to attend it and all. I found out from another friend that my stepbrother went over there and stayed the night that night. And she's starting to act all weird about this stuff now, and I don't know, you know.
Why don't you talk to your stepbrother?
Huh?
Can you talk to your stepbrother?
Yeah.
Well, he's just going to deny it. How old is he?
How old's he? He's 14.
How old is she?
She's 15.
She's 11. She's and where are you now?
Where am I now? I'm in Cincinnati.
You're now in Cincinnati? Is that where you are now, right now?
Yeah.
Where are you now? Cincinnati. Okay, so when are you going home?
I'll be home the first week of August.
I see.
I suggest you end this relationship.
Why? Yeah, I mean, it's a lose-lose situation.
Well, hold on a second. So somebody told you your stepbrother spent the night.
Yeah.
And would there be any reason to spend the night?
I see none.
Yeah, but if you talk to him, I mean...
What's he going to say?
He's going to say, I drank too much, I passed out in the spare room, right?
More like he smoked too much, but basically, yeah.
Right. Hey, do you think those two have had a thing? Do you think they like each other?
I don't know.
Well, then why...
That scares me.
But here's my point. It shouldn't scare you because here's what should scare you. If you noticed a little chemistry between the two of them in the past, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You can't get a read off of her. I mean, most 15-year-old girls who have a 16-year-old boyfriend, even if it's you, Ryan, don't want to go back to some 14-year-old kid.
Right.
Do you ever get any vibe off of her that she had any interest in him?
Sometimes. It's kind of rare, but yeah, a little bit.
A little bit, sometimes, but not much?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, write that down, Drew.
Yeah, Ryan, I don't know. I didn't know where to begin with, Ryan.
All right.
My thing is, hey, you're 15, you're freaked out by your girlfriend.
Can't you talk to your, all right.
You don't trust her. You shouldn't be in the relationship. You can't trust her.
Ryan, this sounds like more you.
Yes.
You sound pretty easily freaked out.
I'm more of the quiet type, but yeah, you could say that.
Yeah, you're quiet, but you're just the kind of guy who snaps and gets a hunting rifle and goes up to a water tower, right? All right, Ryan. All right. Yeah. Oh, wait a minute. He's making a note now, too. Let's see. Get rifle, go to hunting tower. Yeah. Oh, God. Isn't it horrible being a 16-year-old
yes,
man?
Yes, that's true.
You know what I mean?
Oh, absolutely.
You guys remember that? Jealous?
Yeah, yes. It's terrible.
Yeah. Now it's like, you know, you get to be our age, and it's like, listen, is she cheating? Oh, who cares? I got to watch TV. I mean, you care, but you just you're not. Ryan, he's up all night. He's creating elaborate scenarios.
I go to animal models when I think about the young orangutans, you know, jumping around. Then the old guys sitting in the back. You can barely get up.
Yeah, the old orangutans. They're sitting in the tree. Yeah. They're picking stuff off themselves. That's it. You stop picking on other people, you start picking yourself. That's what happens. When you're young, you go pick on everyone else, then you get home. Now you want to be left alone so you can pick it yourself. You got stuff, psoriasis, scaling.
I watch you in your nose every night.
Oh, I go out, I drive home, I got one finger. It's amazing. I can drive a stick and pick my nose the way I do. Thank you, Drew. So what have we learned tonight? I crap in a popcorn bucket and I pick my nose. Anything else, Drew? Want to talk about the time I cried when my hamster died when I was 9? Drew, you'll not rest until I can't get laid.
Yeah.
Right.
Evelyn, what's going on? Quick.
Yeah, I have a question for Jaguares.
Yeah, team.
First of all, hi, Adam. Hi, Drew. I really love you.
All right, now hold on a second. Drew, what are you? How high are you? How high are you? Hey, here's a question Drew wants to settle in 47 seconds. He wants to know.
He'll ask it if he can't bring it. He's not going to get through it.
Well, I just want to know how stupid Drew is. She wants to know how Saul got over his drug addiction, and he says, do it in 30 seconds.
Well, ask her question in 30 seconds.
All right. You're over your drug addiction?
Sort of, yeah.
Yeah, all right, sort of. So, but you're not high now, right?
No, I'm not.
All right, that's over with. How did you sort of get over it, I guess, is the question.
No, it's just that suddenly you get conscious about that and you have to confront it and clean yourself. I mean, it's not so big deal. You have
to. What was your drug? What was your drug of choice?
Well, it's cocaine and acid.
But listen, it's Mexico is different. Everyone does coke.
I'm also not
sure. Mexico, we don't have heroin in Mexico.
I'm not for sure. That's not addiction. That's just using a lot of drug is not addiction.
Okay.
They're two different things.
We're going to take a break. Drew's going to do a quick urine sample of Saul. And we'll
you're looking for some benzoylecanine.
We'll be back after this.
Hello? Who's this?
This is LoveLine.
1-800-LOVE-191. LoveLine will be right back.
These are the sounds of today's kids. And these are the voices of today's kids.
Don't underestimate me. I can work harder in school.
Give me a problem that's hard to solve.
Give me tougher work. Give me tougher books.
When I solve a tough problem, I'm on top of the world.
Surprised? Don't be. 74% of kids say school should only pass them to the next grade when they've learned what's expected of them.
I'm not afraid to fail.
If I make a mistake, I'll do better next time.
75% of kids say they'd study harder if their schools gave them tougher tests. The fact is, almost all kids want to be challenged in school. So listen to the voices of kids today.
Challenge me.
Challenge me. Challenge me.
Do your part. Support higher academic achievement in your state and challenge our schools to challenge our kids. For a free booklet, call 1-800-38-BE-SMART. A message from the Ad Council and the Education Excellence Partnership.
Taking all that work home?
No, this is my own stuff. I've got a date with a financial planner.
You're only 25. Why are you planning for retirement already?
Hey, I want to be able to choose when I retire and know that I'll be financially secure when I do.
I've heard lots of people call themselves financial planners, but aren't they really trying to get you to invest in their favorite fund? Like they're selling size 20 shoes so everyone gets a hello, Bigfoot.
Uh-uh. Half this stuff is my bank statements, company insurance policies, tax returns. The planner's going to know a lot about me before recommending anything. The rest is background information I've collected on her and two other planners. If she passes tonight's round, she gets my papers.
Securing your financial future is important. You have a right to expect financial advice that's competent, ethical, and based on your needs. To verify that a planner is certified, call toll-free 888-CFP-MARK. A public service of the Certified Financial Planner Board of Standards.
It may have happened to you. You may have heard the roar of the rumble strips, the blast of car and truck horns, and the heart-pounding fear of a near miss. Avoid all the dangerous crash action that comes with falling asleep at the wheel. Experience the amazing power nap. You've never seen power like this before. The power nap. Find out what the professional drivers have been doing for years. The power nap gives you the energy you need for the road ahead, and it's free.
Free.
Whether you're driving to the shore with your family, to another city to meet a client, to school across the state, or anywhere there's action. The power nap is your ticket to revitalization. Experience the power nap at a rest stop near you. Just pull in, find a safe, well-lighted spot to park, turn off the key, and close your eyes. In just 20 to 30 minutes, you'll have the energy you need to drive safely for miles. So don't push it, park it. And feel the power of the power nap. A wake-up call to all drivers from the U.S. Department of Transportation and the American Trucking Association.
It's nearly 6 a.m. and we're at a rest stop talking to travelers. Excuse me.
Yes.
Have you ever heard of circadian rhythms?
It's like a Latin band, right?
Not quite. Do you know what circadian rhythms are?
It's when the stars all align and their energy creates...
No. How about you, sir? Huh? Circadian rhythms. Exactly. Circadian rhythms tell your body when it should be sleeping as well as when it should be awake.
Huh?
Circadian rhythms are part of our body's internal controls, a kind of built-in clock that tells us when to wake up and when to go to sleep each day. Imagine the danger that comes when we try to drive when our body thinks we should be sleeping, especially at night, early morning, and for many people, mid-afternoon. You really should try to avoid driving during your body's downtimes. If you have to drive when you'd normally be sleeping and you find yourself getting drowsy, stop for a refreshing 20 to 30 minute nap. Now what would you say when I say circadian rhythms?
I'd say, don't push it,
pocket.
Right.
A wake-up call from the U.S. Department of Transportation and the American Trucking Associations.
Oh, come on, have a drink.
No, thanks.
Just one little drink.
I don't want to.
Chicken, everyone else is.
I said no.
What a nerd. One little drink won't kill you.
You've heard it all before. Be cool, join the crowd, have a drink, even though you're not 21.
Let's go, she's no fun.
Make the right choice. Don't give in. Underage drinking is dumb and dangerous.
Look out!
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
It's the seventh season of HBO's Dennis Miller Live, a new millennium with presidential probes, celebrity scandals, social deviance, and Dennis Miller rants.
Automobiles for you, automobiles for me, automobiles for America, automobiles for all of mankind. Thank you. And now back to the Dennis Miller Ford Automotive Variety Hour.
Join Dennis for all new live editions filled with his scathing perspective, razor-sharp wit, and celebrity guests. Dennis Miller Live, Friday nights at 11:30, only on HBO.
Drew just made a very valid point that Eskimos were worse than Mexicans. Right, Drew. Thank you. And you're sure you're not just kissing the ass because Jaguares is here tonight? All right. I want to thank you guys very much for coming in. The compliment to you, because it always means there was some entertainment to be had. Everyone go out there and support Jaguares. They've been here three times, so they're officially family. And guys, we do appreciate it.
Oh, thank you.
So, until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
Grandes éxitos en español.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station.
The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.